The Beacon is one of the great venues in New York City. This is a real, authentic New York performing space.
This place has so many memories and so many positive ghosts.
What can I say about the place? It's a legend, it's an icon.
It was the Apollo Theater for white guys.
Yeah.
All in all, it's a great place to play. It always has been, but now it's got a new face. When we first took over the Beacon Theater, when you walked into it, you knew it was a special place. But it was a place that had been sort of used up. We had no idea, though, how beautiful that theater could become until we finished doing the restoration.
The Beacon affords you a certain closeness to your audience. And your audience is your strength. Your audience is your staying power. They can get whatever kind of show they want, you know? And the Beacon, they get it.
It's one of those theaters that's large, but when you're on the stage, the audience feels like they're right there. Do you know what I mean? They're not receding into the distance. Sometimes you do these shows out in Los Angeles, and you just feel like the space goes back and back and back and back.
It's just got a very comfortable feel. It's sort of like playing in your living room. Except for all those really big chandeliers.
And there's something about the Beacon where they got the proportions right. That's a big theater, but everyone's right there. I don't know how else to explain it. It's a strange optical illusion.
I don't know how they did it. I don't know how the architect created a situation where you're in an intimate room, but at the same time you feel like you're a part of something that's very big. But the Beacon Theater is that kind of a hall. It has a certain magical quality to it that defies any kind of normal explanation.
So they're right there. It's a wall of people, a sea of people. And of course, being indoors, the response of the applause and the screaming stays with indoors, and it bounces off the beautiful ceiling. And the acoustics are perfect in that theater.
I think people underestimate how important the audience is to the curve of a performance. You know, if you get a kind of lukewarm reaction, it definitely affects the energy level on stage. You know, and in fact, sometimes the consciousness level in there is so high, the place has levitated several times.
Again, the morning comes.
Ultimate high, you can't explain it. To walk out and you see a packed room, especially being here in New York City at a historic venue, it's the ultimate. You can't explain the feeling.
There's always a special experience when artists who obviously can sell at stadiums come to a smaller venue. And I think they've always liked the Beacon because it has its history, a rich history, and that they can give that to their fans to have a more intimate evening. So I love seeing shows here.
I truly was sitting in the last row of the balcony to see David Bowie, and I felt like I could just reach out and touch him on the stage. I believed he could see me in the back.
We want our customers to come in through the front door from the minute they get under our marquee and walk into that rotunda and then walk into the orchestra section to say, this is someplace, and that's what they get now.
Just felt like you was real close with the artist, which is something which is missing today. Like, you don't have like these in-between venues. It's either like, you know, you real far, you know,
or you're in a club with like 800 people and you're like, you know, get off of me, man. You know what I mean? You're too close up on me.
But the space is fantastic. It's a great space. And as I said, it's very authentic. So the minute you get up on the stage, you just feel like, yeah, we could do a great show here. This would be amazing. So the minute we knew that we were, you know, I think we looked at maybe 6 or 7 theaters. But once we saw the Beacon, we knew we have to do it here. And what was great about that experience is that we just camped out for days. I mean, we had all our trucks, and we just lived there. And I live on the Upper West Side. So I loved that period of my life because I would just, walking to work was walking a few blocks to the Beacon Theater. And you really feel like you're in show business. You know what I mean? You feel like Rudy Valley or something. Like you're going to that old marquee, you're walking through that great lobby, and then you walk into that theater and you get up on a stage and you're in show business. You're doing a show. And it really makes you want to put on a show. Let's get people in here and put on a show for them. That's the feeling that you have when you go into the Beacon.
Next time on the...
The Beacon was designed in the mid-1920s by a Chicago architect, Walter Alshager. He was a famous architect in his day, and he designed the Beacon for vaudeville shows and predominantly to show movies. From 1929 until the mid-70s, it was basically used as a movie house. In the mid-1970s, the theater became a rock and roll house. Local promoters decided that it was much more lucrative to do rock shows there than to do movies. MSG gets involved in 2006, and we take over the building on January 1st, 2007.
I think the Beacon represents a kind of tradition that, and this particular sort of tradition, I think, started in the 60s. Even then, there was the idea of sort of renovating a tradition.
Like everywhere else, New York isn't as bad as most places, but they're quick to knock stuff down and build glass condos, you know?
1987, the theater, there was an effort to make the theater a discotheque. That was not received well by the community and by many city officials.
In fact, I remember, I think from the time that I started seeing shows, there was the petition to save the Beacon for the whole, you know, the whole time that I've lived on the Upper West Side, so.
If it was an old movie house or if it was a concert venue, it's very important that culture is kept and neighborhoods are kept.
People love to come and be a part of a historic, to sit in a seat and go, you know, maybe so-and-so sat in the same seat 40 years ago, you know, to watch the Stones, the Beatles, Clapton. For artists to be on stage and feel that same thing, like, man, you know, Eric Clapton sat here back in the, you know, the 70s with Cream, you know what I mean? So that's a beautiful thing.
I think, you know, you're lucky if you have someone that will do that for you. It's rare. I mean, you see so many great places just kind of close down around New York, but if you can, you have cities like New York and Boston where they try to keep that old alive. And it's just so cool. You got to give it to the city, the spirit of the city, that the people care about it.
I think it's really important that places like the Beacon are refurbished and restored to their glory and kept alive, because it's the small venues for musicians and artists and as an actor, I love being on small, intimate stages. And there's not many of them left, you know, particularly when times are tough and the economy is tight. A lot of the smaller places are knocked down and paved over, and, you know, we just don't need another Gap or a Starbucks there. This is the arts, and this country is, you know, needs the arts to stay alive.
They're kind of like mom and pop steakhouses, man, where you really get a good, you know, it's not a chain, you know, doesn't get there frozen in a hard brick. It's kind of like that, you know, it's just an old place. I mean, I would love to just have a film of watching that place being built, you know.
If you don't know the difference between a stadium performance and an intimate performance, you're losing out, I think. Houses like this and, you know, maybe BB, Kings, those are the two places where you really want to see great performances, because it's like you're part of it in a way that you're not in a gigantic stadium.
You're in a space long enough and there are enough great performances in a space, the space starts to inhabit some kind of magic. I really believe that's true. And, you know, the studio where we do our show, Studio 6A, has been this sort of legendary studio here in Rockefeller Center. And I can just feel it. It's just an amazing place for me to do a program. And the same thing with the Beacon. There are these spots here in Manhattan where people have been doing shows for years and years and years and years. And the Beacon is one of the great venues in New York City.
You know, it's nice to see change when it's positive change like that. You know, it's not like we're taking anything away that needed to remain. You know, I think that all the changes, as far as I can tell, have been for the better. And I think it's important to take some place like this and improve it and keep it alive.
No, I'm all for it, everything they did, and I think they did a beautiful job.
Run out of New York, counted out of Major League Baseball, resurrected in Japan.
We can't do anything about the past, but we can do something.
This is MSG.
Radio City Music Hall is an important part of New York City's culture and history. The Beacon Theater also, in the same way, is part of the city's culture and history. We restored Radio City Music Hall. It was just a natural for us to restore the Beacon Theater and do the same thing there.
Well, I mean, for me, the Beacon has always been historical, but a place of fantasy for me. Because you have to understand, I was one of those artists that would fantasize, I'm at the Beacon, right? I'm at Carnegie Hall. I'm at Madison Square Garden. So you walk into these places, they have a natural royalty vibe to them.
We knew we were going to restore the theater when we acquired it. And the process to get us to the restoration was at least a year before. We ultimately shut the building down in August of 2008 and undertook a 7-month renovation. The planning for Paul Simon, the planning for ultimately the Allman Brothers the following month, was just a huge undertaking getting us to to that point.
Had to be back open for the opening, had to be back open for the Allman Brothers to come back. That took kind of incredible amount of logistics to plan that. When you look at some of the photos of how much scaffolding was in the building, clearly we had to take advantage of that scaffolding while it was there. You couldn't forget to change a light fixture on the ceiling once the scaffolding came down. Tremendous challenge to kind of get back up there and fix anything that you might have missed.
What we did is we spent a better part of a year working with architectural firms that understood historic restorations. So we did a lot of research. We went back and we looked in the libraries, we dug up as many photos, we talked to many people that had worked at the theaters or had some association with the theater, we talked with the landlord. You're doing a lot of collection of information. At that point, you have all the information, you say, we think that this is what the theater looked like when it opened in 1929. If we restore it to this, are we going to be happy with the result?
There was some concern as we considered restoring it, what would we find? You know, would this end up looking more like a performance art space? Were the walls yellow? Were they pink? Were the flowers painted red?
And you go, well, I sort of had a different vision of this. And in my imagination, this color looked more like that.
Literally peeling back layers and layers and years of years of kind of just white house paint to see what was originally there. As you first walk into the rotunda, when you see that great room, the richness of it, you know, there was a day that the guy yelled down from the scaffolding that it's gold. We had black and white photographs trying to figure out what the color was there originally. So again, those type of exciting discoveries happen along the way.
It's not a fine arts center, it's a rock theater. It's a rock theater, it's been that way for 3 decades, and we knew we wanted it to be the best rock theater. So there were a lot of compromises that took place along that, but what was most important, and we kept this in mind every step of the way, is let's make sure that when the artist steps out on that stage and the fans rise to their feet, that bond that has existed for 3 decades remains intact.
And the sound is fantastic. There's no echo because of all those rugs and everything. Yet it's not too dead because you got the metal parts, right?
We added a brand new supplemental sound system to the Beacon Theater, which, it already was technically sound as far as audio goes, but we just enhance it to the point where it's just the best sounding experience now anywhere.
Obviously, we have better sound than they did in 1929. We spent, you know, a good 6 months just studying the sound. We did a lot of acoustical testing. We brought in experts that do this for a living. They made a lot of suggestions, some of which you see, some of which you don't. You don't see, for instance, that we have this wonderful thing called the bass trap, and that's hidden behind the proscenium. And the object of the bass trap and its job is to make speech more intelligible. So when a vocalist is singing on that stage, you don't just hear the bass and the drums and the keyboards, you hear the voice.
Because usually underneath a balcony, up under here, if you're sitting here, you'll get guitars only. You'll just get mids. You won't even get all of that. It's called Guitar Alley, we call it. And if you're sitting in the middle, under there, you usually just get blown away by the guitars. You can't hear the drums. And it doesn't happen.
And for me, it was very interesting to see, we actually put supplemental speakers for the last three rows of the orchestra. So you go to that level of detail, it just is an absolute win-win for artists and fans. It's going to be a great show. The artist is never going to sound better, and the fans never going to hear them sound better than they can at the Beacon Theater.
Well, for historic theaters in any city, you know, it's very vital, I think, for the community to keep the art houses open, and that it's not just a commercial venture from big businesses, another multiplex. It's, you know, an old-fashioned show house.
There's a birdcage. What we call the birdcage is a standalone box office kind of outside at the front of the theater, meant to be a very flagship part of the experience when you first arrive there. Over the years, that has been just coated with paint. We were prepared to paint it again. We were doing some research to figure out what the right color was, and what we actually discovered was that it was brass and bronze with real marble. So, again, it was great that our tradesmen were able to come in, really scrape that away, clean it, and restore it to what it was originally intended to be, not just kind of painted gold.
I went through the lobby, and I mean, they cleaned all that stuff. I didn't know all those naked ladies and everything were all around the side, you know, on the brass.
The mural was a backdrop that was, before we got there, it was glued to the wall, and it was falling down. It was a canvas falling apart, and we basically knew that we had to get it down and try to figure out what we do there.
We started looking back at the archival research, talking to old decorating companies. We actually found an ad from the Rambusch Decorating Company from 1929 that was congratulating the architects Rapp and Rapp on having done a great job there. So we were able to find a small picture of what the original mural looked like because Rambusch had done it for the architects. We were able to bring that, find a muralist that we thought could recreate it. But the research has to continue because obviously we have a black and white photograph. So we're in that rotunda looking at the color palette that's there. They also did a lot of research with landscape painting at the time to try and figure out what would have been appropriate. What would that architectural and that painting school have looked for in a mural? And we think we ended up with really a great product in there, but a very exciting mural, kind of adding it back to the rotunda. This is a great example of how we didn't want to treat the theater anymore. This coffee can was actually siliconed on to the base of the chandelier, and the large crystal decorative ball kind of hung off of this with some relatively cheap wire. And it was up in the air, and actually we didn't discover it until we really brought the chandelier down. And we understand it's been up there probably for at least 20 years, and it could have stayed up there for another 20, but it wasn't right. Again, it wasn't the way we wanted to treat the theater, so we were able to work with our architects and landmarks and get a new piece approved that we think is more correct, it's more ornate, it's made in similar materials to the chandelier, it has the same leafing pattern that you'll see in a chandelier. For us, again, the kind of detail that the theater deserves in a long way from this coffee can that was kind of stuck up there.
You know, the magic, though, the real magic, or part of the real magic, is what the public doesn't see. It is what goes on backstage.
Work. Hello, boys, I missed you.
Ron Delzer, of course, has been a part of this for years and is a big part of the neurosis of backstage.
If you played a drum solo longer than 45 minutes tonight, I'll tell you, that thing goes on so long, flies are buzzing around people's heads.
How would you know? You're not here.
Okay, I'm here. I'm gonna give out beer half off when you're on.
Somebody just told him. He's having to read it.
I'm telling you right now, beer is half off. When you do that drum solo,
everybody knows in any band, you know, there's an entire family that goes along with it, and they're all neurotic and nuts and eccentric and stubborn, stuck in their ways, addicted, were addicted, gonna be addicted, soon to be addicted.
There's a passageway underneath the stage that usually has a few tables with sandwiches and potato salad and soda and stuff like that on it. There isn't really a separate dining area for the stars. You often find major stars and members of the stage crew and other people who may be working there all gathered together in the same area there, because there isn't one of those segregated areas for, you know, the big guys. And I think that the big guys appreciate that.
We had those discussions with some of the artists along those lines, and a lot of them said, you know, we know you're going to make it very nice, but just remember, it is the Beacon Theater. We took that into consideration in the backstage areas where our artists are. Of course, we want to give them the most comfortable dressing room areas and production areas backstage that we can, but we did take a lot of that into consideration, and we left some of it alone.
Derek's room right here, he seems to always enjoy that room as well. They're talking about the Beacon Theater and whether it should have been renovated or not.
We had a Grateful Dead shows there. We had about three or four in a row. In those days, people used to like to, I shouldn't really say this on camera, but they used to like to tear up the chairs and throw the cushions as an act of appreciation. You know, most people wave towels today, give you one of these, or hey. But in those days, the 70s, it was destroy everything you can, and take the sinks off the wall, throw cherry bombs in the toilet, I'm giving people ideas, and take the cushions and flip them as you would a Frisbee.
Last year when we played there, it was just, and it was getting to the point, I mean, the dressing rooms were kind of like, you know, Abu Ghraib or something, which has a charm, a kind of, you know, painful charm all its own.
I don't think they had dressing rooms when we played there. We just had like an alley, and you were kind of like making a deal for a burger or a beer or whatever in the alley, and then they, oh, you're on, okay, we're gonna put this out and go on there. So we were in the beginning of the early days when it was just like a, it was like a flashlight. It wasn't a beacon. It was like this.
Something had to be done, you know. So I'm sure. I hear the dressing rooms are really slick now, and you don't expect to be waterboarded or anything when you go backstage, and I think that's important.
Well, you know, carpet. you know, this is all new. You know, I mean, we didn't have flat screen TVs. We didn't have any TVs. We didn't have furniture. We had like old school. You'll get nothing and like it, you know, which is cool. I mean, we're okay with that. But coming in and seeing, oh, wow, it's all schmancy now. And, of course, my dressing room having a picture of Levon on the wall just makes me feel at home. You know, I could do without everything else as long as I got the picture of Levon. That's totally cool.
No, I thought it could use a facelift. I always did, you know. I mean, the elevator's the same. Just ride that elevator one time. You'll see how the whole place used to be.
You know, we never had a practice room before that. This was kind of off limits before. I don't know what was here. Maybe they had to, like, get rid of some dead bodies or something. Sorry, we're going to intrude on you guys' space for a minute. Practice room, which tonight the Duke Horns will be occupying. Who knew this was here? You know? I've been playing here for 20 years. I never knew this room was here. I think they had to knock down some concrete or something.
I'm sure the fire marshal's happy about this whole thing. Get some good wiring in there, some hose it down. They're gonna scrub it, aren't they? Good. They should really scrub it down. Some of those backstage areas need a good going over. You can see places where, you know, Greg Allman licked the wall. The place needs work. That's all I'm saying. Just really scrub it clean. I did some things backstage that I'm not proud of. I don't want to get specific. I think you might be children watching, but if you used a blue light, you'd probably see. Let's leave it at that.
It's a rough crowd still here at the Beacon. I mean, you can change the paint, you can't change the people, brother. You know what I'm saying?
An artist has to take a step before they're ready to play the larger venue. So it has an important place in an artist's career. They're now moving outside of the nightclub space and they're going into the theater space, and they're hoping that their fan base will follow them along with it. You have to make that an enjoyable experience for the same person that is discovering the band for the first time. They weren't there in that black box, to the fan that was there when only 50 people showed up night on a Tuesday night to see them in a black box.
First time I came to the Beacon Theater was 1995. I came to see Boyz II Men. Boyz II Men, ABC, BBC.
We were presenters at an awards ceremony for some musical thing, and then we
had American Music Awards.
Was it?
It was called.
Yeah, American Music Awards. Apparently, it was called.
Yes.
And we handed an award to Andy Warhol, yeah, who came out.
First of all, we said, you know, in recognition for his longstanding achievements, and, oh, it's Andy Warhol. Blah blah blah. And what did he do? He came out. It was like he was stealing it. He walked out on stage, grabbed it, and left.
Not a word. Said, Andy, could you keep it down? And we're running a little long here, so, you know.
I played the Beacon Theater a couple of times, but the first time I played the Beacon Theater was as a part of a radio-sponsored contest, the winner of which was going to get a record deal. And I came here that day and said, I'll play the contest, but I'm pulling out as a competitor because I aspire to something greater. And good thing that I had the foresight, because we would have won the contest with Runaway. First time I ever played here.
I was here for the Stones, when Marty Scorsese shot it.
The importance of making the film on a smaller venue, for me, I contemplate. We discussed doing it in a bigger arena, and I looked into that. And actually, you know, while I was trying to prepare for that, I began to realize I think I'm better suited to try to capture the group on stage, in a smaller stage.
The Beacon Theater is special for some reason anyway. You know, it wraps your arms, especially if you can play there for more than one night. And you start to get, the room sort of wraps his arms around you, you know?
Played here with Phil and Friends, played here with Government Mule. You know, I've sat in here with Widespread Panic and the Black Crows, and can't even remember all the times I played the Beacon. This is definitely the place that I've played more than any other venue.
I actually, the first place I lived when I moved to New York City was the Upper West Side, so I went to see so many shows here. So the fact that, A, it's still here, but that Madison Square Garden has taken the initiative to reinstall it to its glory is fantastic. You know, we should never lose theaters like this.
I think the first show I saw was Steely Dan, and then there were, I think there was a, I want to say James Taylor and Van Morrison. There was a bunch, and you know, the Beacon's been here forever, so it's hard to keep track.
I've been doing shows at the Beacon Theater, I think, since the early 70s. What I did was I had a show that I'll never forget. I convinced Barry Manilow, as I did years ago, to open up the Madison Square Garden Theater, which is now called the WAMO, to open up the Paramount Theater. I convinced Barry to play the Beacon. I had presented Barry Manilow as the opening act and pianist for Bette Midler on Broadway at the Palace Theater. And he had a very tough manager at the time. But I said, no, this is a beautiful theater on the West Side. It's on Broadway. It's a great marquee. Anyway, we had a big press conference, and I walk in, and the ceiling over the stage is pouring rain. And there's a famous photograph I have, black and white photograph, and we're all looking up like this. And Barry's looking straight ahead, seething, talking to the cameras, as we're all looking up, watching the raindrops fall on his head. That was my first real experience that I think I made a mistake leasing the place, subleasing, from these guys who have the lease.
I remember the excitement that I felt being able to introduce Dan Fogelberg, one of my favorites. I was backstage. I lent a cigarette to Mary Chapin Carpenter, and she went off into her dressing room and smoked it. I hope she doesn't smoke anymore.
I remember coming to New York City as a kid. I had an aunt and uncle that lived in the city, and I used to come visit all the time. And we would walk past the Beacon, and I would look up at the lights on the marquee, and I just thought, I want to go in there. I want to maybe perform there, and it was just the place to be, you know? And it was just the hip, cool place to be. That's the difference, you know? It wasn't like a huge amphitheater somewhere out in the middle of nowhere. It's New York City, it's the Upper West Side, and it was the hip, cool place to be.
About a year ago, there was an autism benefit at the Beacon Theater, and they rounded up a lot of different celebrities to do silly, you know, comedians to do silly things. And there was a big song and dance at the beginning with a lot of celebrity cameos. And at some point, I was hidden in the balcony, and my job was to stand up and suddenly sing this sad refrain, and then at the end of the sad refrain, lift up a flute and play a few notes on the flute and then sit back down.
There have just been a lot of happy memories for me at the Beacon Theater. Probably the greatest experience that I ever had. It was unique. I've never done anything like it before or since. When Alan Jackson was performing at the Beacon, it was my job to interrupt his performance by surprise, to walk out behind him while he was on the stage in between songs, tap him on the shoulder, and award him with his very first platinum album. Right in front of the audience, we presented him, Clive Davis, president of Arista Records, and I, we presented him with the big plaque. Alan Jackson's first platinum album was not presented to him in Nashville. It wasn't presented at the Opry House or at the Ryman Auditorium. It was presented on stage on Broadway in New York City at the Beacon Theater.
I knew in the back of my head that the Allman Brothers were coming and they were going to do 15 nights, and it was their 40th anniversary and very important to everyone. I knew once we got to the end of that, that we had really finished and accomplished something.
One, two, three.
The Allman Brothers had broken up. They were broken up for several years. And I had this brainstorm that obviously would be a good idea for many reasons, including financial, for the band to get back together. I choreographed a meeting with a new manager.
It started in 1989 when the band first reformed, and they had played some summer shows supporting their Dreams box set and 20th anniversary tour. And they were having such a good time playing together. Originally they were gonna do 20 shows, and they decided they wanted to continue playing and try and make a record. And it was in the fall, and they decided, Johnny Podell suggested they start playing theaters.
Turn your lamp down low. Wake up, mama. Turn your lamp down low. Got no nerve to turn Uncle John from your face.
I actually stole the idea. I probably shouldn't admit it, but I had read many years ago about Eric Clapton doing, you know, a month at Royal Albert Hall. And with that in the back of my mind, I invented this thing. And but now the secret's out.
They tore the Fillmore down. We needed another Fillmore. And we tried everywhere. We tried Avery Fisher. That was a little too highbrow. We tried our Radio City Music. And I mean, here's the stage and here's the band, you know? It's like the Vegas stages, you know, it's out.
They were already ready to play a couple of nights at the Garden. They had built the following back up. And I thought it would be a good idea to, rather than do that, to take the 40,000 people or whatever and divide it over a number of days. Yes, less money a night, but I felt this was the most important city.
Over a matter of, well, I guess, 3 years, we played probably about six different places. And then the Beacon, it was just it.
Oh, my mama died and left me. My papa died and left me. I ain't good looking, baby, but someone's sweetest child. Yes, I'm going to the country. Baby, do you want to go? Yeah. But you can't make a diamond. Your sister Lucille said she wanna go.
We had originally decided we were going to do three shows at the Beacon, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and then add a Monday, Tuesday. And we put the shows on sale. I called Johnny the next morning to see how the on sale went. and do we get to the all five shows? And he said to me, I'm putting the Thursday, Friday, and Saturday on sale on Thursday. I said, what do you mean? It was supposed to be on sale yesterday. He goes, oh, those five sold out. We've added three more.
And it became a thing, and nobody's ever looked back. Nobody ever gripes about, well, we could make all this money in one or two nights. It just became a thing, and they're very, 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 very comfortable with it.
And what the Rolling Brothers accomplished by doing what we call a residency is historic. They've been playing there about 17, 18 years now. I think they only had 1 year where they didn't play, about 17, 18 year span. And they played 170 some odd shows.
Well, it's funny, it's sort of become a March tradition.
It's almost like the Final Four for basketball. You know it's March, or early April, it's going to be the Allman Brothers Band. And if they don't come, as what happened last year, they sold out, I think, 10 or 12 shows, and they didn't come because Greg took ill. And what people, what? There's a big chunk of their life that's missing.
It all makes a sort of a community. I mean, the local community. I know that last year when we didn't play, the local restaurants, you know, were complaining. Like, where'd our March business go? I think they all realized how much business the band brought into the neighborhood.
There are times in March you get into a taxi. I've had the experience. And a cab driver will turn around and say, where are you going, the Beacon? So that's nice. That means it's seeped into the consciousness of New York.
He's like, how long have you been in New York? I think I just started Saturday Night Live. So it was probably about maybe 10 years ago. And I was like, oh, you know, just maybe like a couple years. He's like, so have you seen the Allman Brothers at the Beacon? I go, no. He's like, yeah. Then you haven't really lived in New York.
I do know that when Eric Clapton recruited Derek Trucks to come out and tour with him for 15 months, he asked Derek if he would have any conflicts. And Derek says, I don't have any conflicts. I'm just not available in March. That was his answer. And Eric sort of looked at him and said, oh, yeah, how come? He goes, I play the Beacon in March every year with the Allman Brothers. And he knew that was something that he owed to this band. And something he owed to himself. It's something that we've become a tradition.
Passed by with Donald Fagen, who's as you know, he and Walter Brecker are Steely Dan. And he says, does this happen every night? Says, well, yeah, they've established themselves with now. They can do 10, 12, 13 nights. This started off. He said, I want to do this.
I think the first time we did it five nights, and it was packed every night. And so next year we expanded it to six nights, and then seven the last time. So, you know, maybe we'll even expand it, and maybe we'll get to Allman Brothers level one day, you know.
The Beacon is important because it's lifeline to musicians like Paul Simon, like Wyclef Jean, like Eric Clapton, like Sting, you see what I'm saying, like Bono, like you too, like, because you will come to New York and you will play the Beacon Theater.
We got some other real heavies coming.
Sort of made it interesting that they bring out all these different people, and it was always different, and it was always about them having fun on stage, and they're hoping the audience enjoys it.
The two things that keep this band together are the memory of Duane Allman and the Beacon Theater. I would say that's true. They're a bunch of crotchety old men. They complain a lot. They love the Beacon. They can see themselves never touring. We're at that point. They never see the Beacon ending.
It's just sort of the right thing for everybody. I think the audience loves it. We love it. It's what we do. It's a Greg Allman quote. It's what we do.
Yeah.
Beacon's a rock and roll treasure. It's known throughout the country as the iconic place in New York City to play. The artist, as well as the fans, just keep coming back, ensuring the survival for, I'm sure, many years to come. The greatest feeling is when Paul Simon comes out for the first song, and I'm just sitting there saying to myself, here we are after 8 months, $16 million, and 1,000 different people being involved in this project. We're finally there, and what a great feeling.
Paul Simon is, he seems like a fixture of New York, a New York classic. And I mean that in the best way. and so is the Beacon. So it's a perfect classy mix, I think.
I mean, there's no bigger New Yorker music, theater, Paul Simon. Who do you think of, you know?
You don't feel you could love me, but I feel you could. You don't feel you could love me, but I feel you.
Quintessential New York, it's Paul Simon. I mean, I'm gonna yell out, play You Can Call Me Al, because I figure he's gonna forget that song. And I think he'll be happy that I yelled out a reminder. And he'll be like, cool, thanks, buddy, because I totally forgot about that song. And I'll probably slur my words when I do it. Just play You Can Call Me Al. He's like, okay. And then hopefully he'll be like, You Can Call Me Al.
Best, and he is New York, and he, you know, has scored our lives for most of us. My mother was a huge fan of his and had his 45 records when they were 77 cents at EJ Corvettes.
This is the guy who, on vinyl forever said, you know, we got to thank the guys in Central Park who sell the loose joints. I mean, come on.
And it's pretty wild to know him now as a grown woman myself and actually have a meal with him. Halfway through the meal, I usually go, holy that's Paul Simon. I have to talk myself down.
Born in Queens, he was Forest Hills, I'm Flushing. I mean, I loved his music. We actually lived in the same building for about 10 years, the same apartment building. You know, he's always been there for us. I mean, for concerts, for charity, for a million different things. He's a prolific songwriter for the movies. And, he's just one of the greatest singer-songwriters of our generation, an amazing performer on top of it.
Well, you know, he is New York. You know, you don't get very much more New York than Paul Simon, so it's very exciting.
You know, it's like local boy done good. He's come back to the ancestral homestead to entertain us.
Well, I think that I've been out probably seeing shows well over 100 nights a year for 30 years. You know, I know in 5 minutes. If this is a night when the audience is right there with the performer, you know, you can just judge that, you can feel it in the house. And we knew, because we had arranged for the special guest appearance of Art Garfunkel, I knew that it was already a terrific night. I already felt the energy. You could see it, that the stars and the celebrities that were in the audience, they weren't removed from it. They weren't with their handlers. Paul McCartney didn't have a bodyguard. He was there with everyone else. And I knew the best was still to come. And of course, when Art walked out on the stage, it was the whole theater elevated 6 feet. It was a wonderful experience for everyone.
I think bringing Paul Simon on board for the Beacon is a blessing. It's almost like saying we're back and we're bringing real music back to New York City.
These are the days of miracle and wonder. This is the long distance call. The way the camera follows us in slow-mo. The way we look to a song.